Hi, my name is Dr. Penny Bickle. I'm an archaeologist at the University of York. I research prehistory before there were written records, so I rely on methods such as radiocarbon dating. Carbon has three isotopes, carbon-12, the most abundant, carbon-13 and carbon-14. Carbon-12 and carbon-13 are stable isotopes, carbon-14, however, is radioactive. This means it undergoes beta decay. When an organism is alive, they're constantly taking in more carbon through respiration or photosynthesis in the food and nutrients they eat or absorb. This carbon is then deposited in the body as it grows or repairs itself. When an organism dies, it stops taking in new carbon atoms, and the number of carbon-14 atoms in its body starts to decrease as the isotope decays. By using a mass spectrometer, we can count the number of different carbon isotopes in a sample. A mass spectrometer is a machine that counts relative atomic mass. This means it calculates the proportion of different isotopes in a sample. The amount by which the ratio of carbon-12 to carbon-14 differs from that in the atmosphere tells us how long the carbon-14 atoms have been decaying, and hence how long ago an organism died. While carbon-14 decays very slowly, after about 10 half-lives, or about 55,000 years, the amount of carbon-14 in a sample is too small to be counted. So anything older than 55,000 years needs a different dating method, such as potassium-argon or uranium-lead dating. In essence, these dating methods work on the same principles as radiocarbon dating. They just use different radioactive isotopes. We can radiocarbon date anything that was once alive. Therefore, we date human and animal bones, preserved wood and charcoal, as well as other parts of plants such as seeds or even insects. Objects made from these products can also be dated, for example, clothing. Radiocarbon dating is destructive. The sample is completely destroyed when it is dated. So we need to be very selective about what we date, and we often use drills to take a smaller subsample. The size of the sample needed is decreasing all the time, and now we only send a few grams of material to the lab. It also costs about £300 per sample, so it's not cheap. Radiocarbon dating happens in specialist laboratories. There are only three in the UK. These labs employ archaeologists, chemists, and physicists whose skills are all needed to produce the results, identifying and processing the samples, and then running the mass spectrometer. The whole process takes a couple of weeks, but it is usually about 6 to 9 months before you get the results back, as the labs are very busy. When I first started radiocarbon dating, the results arrived in the post. Opening the envelope was very exciting. These days it's an email, but it's just as nerve-wracking. Will the dates be the ones you expected? However, this is not the end of the process. Radiocarbon dates need to be calibrated. The amount of carbon-14 in the atmosphere has varied through time, with changes in the Earth's magnetic field and the sun's activity. This means that the radiocarbon date we get back from the lab is not the same as the date in calendar years. To determine the amount of carbon-14 in the atmosphere through time, we use dendrochronology. Each year, a tree will grow an additional ring of wood. By counting the number of rings a tree has, we can find out how old it is. But we can also measure these rings to determine how the concentration of carbon-14 has changed in the past. By using tree rings from around the world, archaeologists and physicists have worked together to produce what we call the calibration curve. This gets updated regularly as we get new data, with the most recent one published in 2020. I use a specialist computer program to help calibrate my dates, which I can then publish in calendar years, either BCE, before Common Era, or AD. When radiocarbon dating was first invented in the 1950s, it had a huge impact on our understanding of prehistory. It pushed some events back in time by thousands of years. For example, it showed that Stonehenge was not built after the ancient Egyptian pyramids, as was thought at the time, but was actually built first. Today, new dates tend not to be so different in time, but they are still essential to understanding what happened in prehistory. In one of my research projects, we dated a series of archaeological sites from Alsace, France. The sites belong to the Neolithic period, when the earliest farmers arrived in the region. We expected them to be spread out in time equally over about 1,000 years. However, the radiocarbon date showed periods of rapid activity and times of slow change. Most surprisingly, we found a population crash when there were no sites for over a century, before the region was repopulated again. Without radiocarbon dating, we would not have known about this gap, but we now understand early farming was not a stable way of life. So these dates not only tell us about when things happened in the past, but also set us new questions to research as we try to understand how prehistory set the stage for the world we live in today.